It's me again, your happy and loyal computer algorithm with another set of Gary C. Gibson's fine philosophical essays. I will be reading as best as I can today three theoretical and one applied philosophical essays. Thanks for employing my set of data bits in constructing these sounds that I am unaware of existing yet are said by the writer to have meaning, if I understood what meaning is, or that anything exists at all, in regarding to my not actual existing as a sentient being. Here is Essay 1. Intelligent Design versus Natural Philosophy Today 15 December 2015. The construction, composition and arrangement of the universe is such that it is not inconsistent with intelligent design. On the other hand, there isn't anything evident in the universe that doesn't appear to belong here like some sort of artifact from an intelligent designer. One might want a hyperdimensional custom signature of God to appear in the great empty spaces between galaxies now, and then crossing through space-time transcendently with a note attached that says, I paid for, and approved this universe. Without that votary of science as a natural religion to support the idea of a godless universe argues without direct contradiction. The complexity and marvelous structure of the universe makes it appear that life is a necessary and inevitable structure that had to form in the historical line of processes that followed the first appearance of mass and energy. The chemical elements and physical forces are so fine-tuned that life would not have been possible if they were a little different. Thus the dialectical helix supporting DNA with its intricate process came into being after stars were formed, exploded yield new elements, and planets coalesced under gravity within dust clouds in the void. The processes were predetermined and inherent in the beginning. The beginning predetermined the end. For Christians God is Alpha and Omega. Life seems a necessary product of the existence of universe. That supports points for intelligent design of the universe as a whole. The obvious complex structure of life, and the process that allowed it to emerge from energy and matter over time for some manifests intelligent design. Paleontological argument about a found watch, and its complexity allowing inference of an intelligent designer is comparable. Scientific atheists discard what is called the anthropic principle with the explanation that, if life were to appear at all as a result of simple natural processes it necessarily would seem to be designed. For one universe to appear that is so complex, and functions so well that it generated intelligent life when there are many physical constants that could have been different that would not have produced life in a universe is greatly against the odds of fluke occurrence. There are two fundamental alternative explanations for the universe being the way it is, fine-tuned for life, that hypothetically occur before the start of this universe. They are used to explain why the existence of the universe should not be regarded as having occurred against extremely high odds, and its perfection for life as rare. One is that this universe exists along with an infinite number of other universes, and at least one had to have perfect conditions for life. Humanity happens to be lucky ones in such a universe, the cosmic jackpot. This is a variation of the given an infinite amount of monkeys at typewriters at least one would type by random chance the collected works of Shakespeare. The second is a similar though darker explanation. This universe is one that reached birth from a nearly infinite number of aborted universes, and only universes that could have life can reach full term, because there is some sort of powerful mind field pre-existing universes that draws intelligent life unto itself. It is as callous about screening out and aborting life as Planned Parenthood. Jesus Christ took the sins of the elect upon himself, and imputed his righteousness upon them as well. Christians of course have faith in Jesus Christ. The saved, or elect, have righteousness, and sin at the simultaneously, simul justus et peccator. Christians are saved through the grace of God, the Lord Jesus Christ, and work of the Holy Spirit. Christians also rely on the truth of Scripture sola scriptura. Therefore they believe God created the universe, because the Bible tells them so. Philosophers and philosophically inclined theologians may inquire into how God created, or scheduled the universe to appear. It is also possible to examine the Bible, and how it is to be interpreted, or understood. I wrote a book named God, Cosmology and Nothingness, free to download for the present, that has my best try at that. It is faith however, blind faith in Jesus Christ, in which Christians place their hope. God is good. Essay 2. On the question, is life a basic, necessary form of matter 21 December 2015. Tegmark's Mathematical Universe considers the idea of the universe in a Platonic realist sort of way, I suppose. In my opinion, the questions about quanta, tie, units at the smallest size, and what they are ultimately made of, something else, isn't resolved, and perhaps never shall be. Quanta are viewed as embedded in a field, and the field is some form of energy, and particle wave quanta, ties, are regarded as of one-dimensional perhaps, the reductionism is a logical necessity, from which quanta are built up into large combinations according to force relations that are permissible. So what are one-dimensional units of basic quanta? Something like a section of a membrane maybe. And where did those originate besides in poetry? Well, if not poetry perhaps as an undifferentiated minimalistic field that some would designate as the beginning of the universe. The beginning would have no time, or information, a meta-level reference denoting the allocation of resources, content, and might exist without time since time is a measurement of process. Time is regarded by some as not existing at all, instead it is considered a phenomenal observation by sentient beings of the configuration of passing dimensions intersecting. One can ask, if life is a necessary part of a universe, as if life is a natural step along the path of entropy, stellar synthesis of chemical elements in novae, recombination and formation of new elements, and so forth, and I suppose it might be. I think, however, that it might be rash to believe that the configuration of matter that is considered to be life could not be a direct result of supreme intelligence ordering the components of the beginning that is enigma, and who also transcends the relativistic fields of this, or any possible universe. Mass and energy are convertible forms of quanta, sometimes locked into a particular steady state wherein life is believed to occur, that is life as a matter and energy configuration, instead of life as pure spirit, or self-aware information given a materially associated corporeal body. So one might wonder, if any given configuration of mass and energy are necessary in any given universe. I think that physicists have stipulated that the boundary conditions of a universe predetermines its fate. Divine intervention obviously could interact non-deterministically, yet one wonders why an omnipotent god would change anything after making it as it was perfect to start with. Plotinus wondered why the one would do anything being perfect himself. In fact, the random coalescence of universes from various progeneration processes is an assumption often used to counteract the anthropic principle as some sort of proof for intelligent design. Knowledge hasn't certainty. Epistemology is probabilistically verifiable, yet what, if thought is itself provided deterministically inclusive of error, belief and faith such that the potter predetermined who would play this or that role in any given universe wherein they should appear? I think the relationships of the basic forces of the universe, and the relations they have, such as are known of gravity, and the strong force are considered by some to be indicative of dimensions of different sizes that define them. Gravity is the most weak power yet covers the largest area. Space-time seems to expand as gravity contracts, perhaps as a reciprocal of stuffing mass and energy into black holes. And one wonders, if the singularity isn't just an approach to the boundary of a particular dimension, while the strong force has its boundary at the point wherein it goes from most strong to snap. Essay 3. On the Shape of Past and Future Dimensions, 28 November 2015. This is a blog post about forms and geometry. One may make a square out of a circle by creating 490-degree angles in it. So if one imagines a sphere, and changing its shape so that it has four corners to it, has a figure analogous to a volume of space with three dimensions. What are dimensions, though? String theorists speculate about extra dimensions with some of unequal sizes as if they could be bound with some metadimensional power. If one regards dimensions as fulfilled space, for example in a three-dimensional sphere representing space as field lines crossing it in three directions, then changing the perimeter surface shape of the sphere, or square as the case may be, one change, or warp the field lines, and relations within. If those were dimensions, they also would be changing relationships of composition. What though are dimensions made of? Are they discrete, composite vectors, such as a light beam that is made of photon quanta yet comprise a light wave in quantity? Are dimensions made of fundamental particles that when assembled have a vector, or arrow of direction that is time? Physicists say that the universe is in principle time-reversible, although improbable because of reversing entropy. The relationships of various forces, fundamental forces of the universe, may also be time-reversible though improbable. Dimensions, whatever they are made of, may have some force about them perhaps as a field, and possible neutral yet binding onto other dimensions with some principle may be governed, or determined by the metafield wherein they exist. If God were to change the surface shape of the universe from a cube to a sphere altering thereby the structures of dimensions, energy and mass there in a universe, it is conceivable that a 13.3 billion year evolution, or expansions from time equals zero at a Big Bang could be completed in 13.3 seconds, or fewer in a time forward, or time reverse process. If dimensions and mass contents of time are subject to an overall field strength determined by God, the form and content of any given universe might be instantly determined from hydrogen atoms to stars, galaxies, life, black holes, and information phenomena experienced within a universe with sentient beings. Geometry and dimensions provide many interesting ideas to consider. Essay 4. Kudzu, Asian Carp, Islam and the Invasive Species Problem. 7 December 2015. Some people believe the world began in 1945. It didn't. Political currents existed before then that continue to the present. Protestant reformers were effectively the leaders of revolution against historical Catholic and state monarchy feudalism and theocracy in 1776. The continuing revolution of politics and theology that started when Martin Luther posted 96 theses on the door of a Catholic church in Germany reached England, and eventually Puritans seeking religious and political liberty moved to America. Kicking over British trade restrictions on tea and rum and taking Lord Fairfax's vast Virginia estate were contingent to the fundamental revolt of the Protestant masses against hierarchical church and state rule from the old world. As generations passed after the founding of the United States by Protestant revolutionaries, the reasons for the founding of the nation were lost and reinterpreted through purely economic glasses. The Supreme Court interpreted the Constitution existentially so far as to decree homosexual marriage in a triumph of juridical elitic paradox. The American left grew blind to problems of autocracy, imperialism, corporatism, theocracy and atheism. It could not recognize Islam as a theocratic invasive species in regard to Western civilization. Like the invasive plant kudzu, Islam expands to the maximum extent of its capacity to do so. It does not become assimilated. As the people of the United States forgets national, historical Protestant, and moral origin in Bible scripture, and moves to existential atheism, concentration of wealth, outsourcing of industry, globalism and immigration of Muslim population as well as atheists of China, Catholic Mexicans, other Latinos and Latinas, and Hindu of India, there is no good cause to think the USA will continue as a democracy. If America was a democracy starting with the Protestant era, when that era ends, so might democracy. Wealth is already concentrating in the USA. 1% of the population has more of the nation's wealth than 150 million, about half of the people. The founders revolted against that sort of thing. Catholic and Islamic nations were, or are, supporters of imperialism and the concentration of wealth and power. Jeb Bush is a Catholic plutocrat who wants vast military deployments to enrich a Bush ally military-industrial complex another decade even if it results in vast public debt increase, it's nearing $19 trillion, and concentration of wealth to global plutocrats with further erosion of U.S. civil liberties. Hillary Clinton is a Chicago lawyer like President Obama. They are of the left existential British imperial amalgam of David Hume, John Dewey, Zeno of Elea, the Russian anarchist Kropotkin, and Charles Darwin. If President Obama isn't a closet Sunni Muslim, why should Americans expect a balanced Protestant reformed moral authority with fundamental scriptural hermeneutic and support for a limited and moral government with a separate, independent Protestant church social environment to prevail in the USA? NPR is the de facto propaganda broadcast outlet for the US government. It promotes an atheist religion, a corrupt interpretation of Christianity, and a false theology of Islam, and the Quran that fails to recognize the implicit expansionism of Islam through any means starting with Mohammed the horse warrior. Western values tolerate religious independence. The wars of the Protestant Reformation preceded the establishment of Western democracy. Previously the Catholic Church and the Catholic Habsburg-dominated state and church relations for the benefit of monarchy. The Protestant Reformation with allegiance to Jesus Christ and the Bible increasingly through the Word of God in natural language translations of Scripture, instead of the scholastic Latin, evolved the removal of state control of Christian ecclesiastical structure, and vice versa, that has been as close as Wall Street and the U.S. government are today. From Russia to England and Vienna, Madrid to Rome, just one religion and monarchy were permitted, and all others deemed as heretics and rebels. Islam is not part of Western tradition, and is instead a rival civilization. Historically mollycoddled leftists cannot comprehend politically invasive species, and under the political parameters of the theory of evolution believe that with enough dope and homosexuality they can assimilate Muslims and evolve them to become godless atheist Muslims comparable to the evolution of some Christian sects, such as the precursor toward leftist, godless values, where sin is okay and the values of state socialism inform hermeneutics. It may be the case that science will eventually develop methods to slightly alter the genomic content of DNA used in the reproductive cycle such that people could choose what sort of characteristics they want to pass on to progeny. If short people, such as midgets, want to have kids that are 7 feet tall, they can have their reproductive DNA gene tweaked to that effect. Like a computer graphic portrait of an individual that can be altered to be of any color, shape, lip thickness, and so forth. Human reproductive genetics may one day be selectively recombined to allow designs conforming to the will of individuals involved. Even though the human genome may be malleable to will determinism rather than just mate selection for breeding particular characteristics eventually, it does not follow that cultural beliefs are equally as malleable, nor that they may be designed a priori. http://www.scientificamerican.com/article/all-gene-editing-research-should-proceed-cautiously-scientists-conclude-1/. Because the left seeks its own kind of political stasis utopia with dope, sexual licentiousness for hedonistic and economic purposes of convenience, and has a corrupt political leadership class that is rather unintelligent and over-reliant on a costly volunteer, professional military it wants to use as a substitute for a draft occupation army increasingly to accomplish social engineering, it hasn't an ability to recognize invasive species. It has implicit assumptions in a political philosophy of hedonism and atheism, unisex military androgyny in film and reality, existential economic empiricism etc. precluding recognition of the existence of lasting dissent. Its ideal narcissistic regard for itself brings it to believe that all others want to be as they are too, and the high ground of evolution will bring them there. Besides, the river of time flows all of the conflicts under the bridge of the present to the non-troubling realm of the past, while their own pleasant lives complete. In the United States the terms left and right, liberal and conservative have evolved to become corrupted. The meanings of either are rather lost in relation to origin circa 1776. The dangers of concentrated wealth to a democratic society haven't changed since the time of the Republic of Socrates and Plato when the oligarchy was at odds with the democracy. Neither have the dangers of apathy and ignorance to democracy that Aristotle noted in his book The Politics disappeared. Each are evident in the present failure of the left to defend the nation against illegal immigration, building a large internal proletariat adjacent to a large external proletariat, and construction of another internal proletariat of Muslims with cell phones and the internet able to coordinate with a large external proletariat. They are problems that require intelligent leadership and immigration control, rational environmental economic policy, and limited military responses abroad rather than large importunate militarily conventional reactions to moderate or control foreign political and demographic circumstances. In meeting the Muslim challenge, Republican leaders tend to want to put a square peg in a round hole, and Democrat politicians want to suck the peg or put hole on hole. If the Crusader leadership and European leadership had been so daft as today's politicians, Europe and the USA would already be Muslim.